I am not entering into the debate whether he was atheist or agonist. That is for the researchers and scholars to decide upon. But the fact remains, the need of the secular education with a scientific temper, absorbing the Western culture and civilizations, essential ingredients of them, without losing control over ourselves and being swayed by the influence of Western culture and education, was the contribution to my mind of Pandit Ishwar Chandra Vidyasagar. I had the privilege of going through some of his writings as early as 1970, when we decided to bring out his publications in several volumes with the assistance of the then Government of India. And I still remember, these books were released by no less a person than Prime Minister Indira Gandhi, along with the presence, in the presence of Srimati Aruna Sofal, who was also associated with us, and Justice Gajendra Gadkar, who was presiding over the 150th year anniversary of Pandit Ishwar Chandra Vidyasagar. The short point which I am trying to drive at, Vidyasagar did not bother about, nor he declared any crusade against religious practices, but he kept it aside. The main theme of his social reforms was nothing but compassion, and that he derived from his day-to-day experiences in his own life, in his own environment. The sad plight of a young widow or of his teacher, that moved him, and he recognized there is need of social reforms. Widow Remarriage Act, the passage of which is a glorious struggle on the one hand, progressive forward thinking of a section of the society, and the strong determination of the conservative section of the society to oppose it. Even his life was at risk. We are told that his father, being anxious of his safety, had to send somebody from Birsinghon to protect him all the time. That was the atmosphere. And what he preached, he practiced. Not merely delivered his ideas from the podium, but in his practical life he practiced. It was not easy in those days to encourage his own son Narayan to marry a widow, despite the strong oppositions from the near and dear ones, from the family members, because he believed that this is absolutely essential. In this context, I would also like to draw the attention of the distinguished members of the faculties and guests. Sometimes I have shared this perception with my audience in different university convocations. If I look at, from one side of the spectrum, I find that there has been a tremendous expansion of the physical infrastructure of our higher education system. Right now, when I am talking before you, there are as many as 669 degree-giving institutions in India. More than 33,000 colleges, during 11th plan itself, 8 more IITs, 15 institutes of technology, national institutes of technologies have been established. There is no doubt that the rate of recruitment from our IITs, whether it is Kharagpur or in Kanpur, or at Delhi or at Mumbai, is very high. The graduates are immediately absorbed, but is that the aim of the higher education? So when I look at the survey report of an international reputed organization, that out of 200 top world-class universities, not a single Indian university, not a single Indian IIT or NIT finds its place, whereas the universities of Hong Kong, Saudi Arabia, they find place, apart from Europe and American universities. But that was not the case. So far higher education is concerned, all of you, this distinguished gathering, is fully aware. India dominated the scene of higher education not one or two decades, but almost 1800 years. In the field of higher education, Indian universities dominated. Starting from Takshashila in 6th century BC, which had the confluence of four civilizations, to Nalanda, Pallavi, Vikramshila, Udhampuri, up to the destruction of Nalanda in 12th century AD, these long 1800 years Indian university systems dominated the higher education of the world. Why can't we have it? There is no lack of talents. I'm sure. There is no lack of teachers, talented teachers. Talented students are there, talented teachers are there. But where it is lagging that we could not coordinate and bring it to the desired results? I am not talking of the parts, I am not talking of the individual facilities or not. But I am talking of the research, development, advancement of knowledge. Really, I fail to understand. In British India, in the early 30s, when a scientist, despite all odds, could obtain Nobel Prize in 1933, working in Calcutta University, Sir C.V. Raman in physics, why we have to wait more than 8 decades to have another C.V. Raman from another Indian university? It is not there is lack of talents. During this period, graduates of 3 Indian universities, Calcutta, Chandigarh, and Madras, Dr. Amartya Sen, Hargobind Khurana, and Dr. Chandrasekhar, obtained Nobel Prize in the recent years. They obtained it, Indian graduates, Indian postgraduates. Graduates and Indian graduates from, postgraduates from Indian universities, but doing research work in other areas, other universities, other institutions. Lack of inspired teacher, lack of inspired education administrators. Recently I read the story of one Vasishthanara, and it simply opened my eyes that I do not know how many Vasishthanarans are there. A young talented boy, son of a very, in fact, the constable of Bihar Armed Police, passed school for leaving examination from Natural Heart School near Ranchi and got admitted into the Science College of Patna. And one day, when his teacher was trying to solve a problem on the blackboard, somehow or other the teacher might have missed some step. The solution was not coming, and the boy was a little restless. Then the teacher's attention was drawn and he asked him, "What do you want?" He said, "Sir, the process you are doing, it will never be solved." Teacher was angry, but at the same time invited him that come and solve the problems. The boy went to the rostrum, erased the board, solved it in no time. The teacher, being instead of angry, invited him that come at the recess to my room. And the boy was extremely nervous that now surely I will be expelled from the college and it will bring to an end of my education, because I am totally charity boy of this college. The teacher asked him, "Then how do you know?" Then he was accompanied by a couple of his friends. They said, "Sir, from the very beginning it is his passion. He does nothing, always with a pencil and a piece of paper. He just goes on solving the problem, mathematical problem." He was so impressed. Then he took him to the principal. Name of the principal is Dr. Nagendra Rao. He was equally impressed. And they decided to take him to the university vice chancellor. And I am not telling the story of ancient period. It was in the 80s, late 70s and 80s. At that time, Indian Mathematical Society was to meet at Patna. And Professor Kelly from Los Angeles, California University, was to be the guest in chief, was an eminent mathematician. The boy was sent at the initiative of vice chancellor, principal and teacher to be a delegate, an undergraduate student to be a delegate in the mathematical conference, and he presented a paper. Kelly was so impressed that he invited him to join. He did not understand that the boy is not even graduate. He invited him to join the faculty of California University. Then when it was discovered, I am not going to elaborate the story, but the short story is, university broke the rules. With the determination of a teacher being impressed by his student, the boy appeared two examinations simultaneously, graduation, post-graduation, and thereafter sent to California, and he got a faculty position in California. His later life is tragic, but that has nothing to do with it. The short point which I am trying to drive at, that if we have these assets, then something is lacking which we are not in a position to put together so that we can get the desired results. It would be my most respectful submission to this very distinguished gathering. I have departed from my written text, which I will give to the Vice Chancellor for the record. But what I thought, that I should share some of my perception with this very distinguished gathering. The third point on which I would like to emphasize on, where also you will have to play the role. I am repeating. As I started my career as a teacher, and but for accident, if I would have continued, I would have been quite happy. But I don't know what, somehow, something invisible is there which drive people from one position to another. I had to give up that noble profession, but still I believe the teachers and the enlightened sections of the society can be the turning point in the change of our society. There is no doubt that we are passing through a transition. And the transition is, this country has the great potentiality of being the world's top class power, sitting in the high table of the world power. But education is to play a role. Please remember, before the birth of Indian National Congress, the founder of Indian National Congress, he wrote a letter to the 50 graduates of Calcutta University. Couple of sentences were there that if you who have got the opportunity in this given situation to know more than your brethren, is it not your responsibility to pay it back? Surely some of them were inspired and did what is part of history now. The point which I am trying to drive at, that each one of us has an obligation to the society, because we are ultimately the products of the social investment. And if society has invested in me, they can expect a legitimate dividend from me. And all educated men and women in this country are to pay its dividend to the society. If we do so, then all the social aberrations which we find today and for which we try to find out a simple solution, administration, government is to do the job, we may have some sort of satisfaction. We may express our views by venting our feelings in angry criticism, but it will not lead to the solution. Government can do many things, but it cannot do anything and everything. To reset the moral compass, to restore the core civilizational values which are absolutely lacking today, is the primary job of the educational institutions, higher education, to inculcate in the mind of their students, and that too from the primary level to the university level. Certain essential ingredients are absolutely imperative if we want to overcome the present problems, social degradation, which are noticed in different sections of the society, can be. And that is the message, perhaps, Pandit Ishwar Chandra Vidyasagar gave. He gave the path. Message that struggling does not come to an end. It is a continuing process, as the process of learning is a continuing process. What we find correct, we shall have to work for it. There may be tremendous odds. Yes, we can discuss different aspects of Vidyasagar's character, his contribution in the society, plus points, minus points, maybe a very interesting subject for future prospective researchers, but for practical life, what I feel is absolutely necessary to inculcate those values for which he stood. He did not bother about religion. but he bothered about the sincerity. Sincerity of purpose, honesty in life, respect for others, respect for women, almost worship for women, which this society is lacking today, I'm sorry to say. Mere by giving constitutional guarantees of equality, that cannot be restored unless the society as a whole asserts itself, and especially the bright young men and women. There will be too many odds, but if you start fighting, you can overcome odds. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. I am afraid I have exceeded my time, which I wanted to have. Once again, I express my deep gratitude to you, Mr. Vice Chancellor, and your colleagues, for giving me this opportunity of sharing some of my perception with this very distinguished gathering. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen.
Professor Ranjan Chakraborty, Vice Chancellor, will now deliver the formal vote of thanks.
Kind enough for visiting our campus and delivering the 7th Vidyasagar Memorial Lecture. Sir, we are indeed moved by your generous gesture and humbleness, and we will cherish in our hearts the memories of this event. We are proud to witness the event, which is the first of its kind in the history of the university. Sir, we are enriched by your invaluable wisdom, which is an absolute bliss for us. I express my heartfelt thanks to Sri M.K. Narayanan, the Governor of West Bengal and the Chancellor of our University, for his august presence on the occasion. Sir, please accept our sincere regards. I convey my thanks to Sri Bratto Basu, the Honorable Minister, Sri Shubhendu Adhikari, one of the most dynamic members of the Parliament of India, for kindly acceding to our request to grace the occasion. And we are indebted to all of them. I sincerely acknowledge the active cooperation and help from the members of the press and media, Poshim Medinipur District Administration, especially to the DM, Mr. Muhammad Ghulam Ali Ansari, Poshim Medinipur District Police, especially to Ms. Bharati Ghosh for her support, the Executive Engineer, the PWD, the West Bengal State Electricity Distribution Company Limited, and I would also like to extend thanks to all our esteemed colleagues at the Honorable President's Secretariat, Rashtrapati Bhavan, New Delhi, and Honorable Governor's Secretariat, Raj Bhavan, Kolkata, for their active support and guidance. I would like to thank each and every university teacher of Vidyasagar University, officer, non-teaching staff, research scholar, students, and the members of the steering committee who have extended their best possible efforts to make the program a grand success. I would also like to thank the audience for kindly accepting our invitation and for your kind presence today. Thank you very much. Thank you very much.
All are requested to kindly stand up. National anthem will be played now.